Welcome to this very special edition with a chat with Jed. As you might guess, the photo behind Ankit actually lets it out. This is going to focus on drones, but the person who made that possible is actually with us today. We have Ankit Mehta, founder and CEO of IdeaForge and co-chair of the FICCI drone committee. Ankit has a fascinating journey. He actually completed his dual degree, and started with a team of IIT Mumbai or IIT Bombay people, which is to form IdeaForge in early or mid 2000, right? Actually 2007. He is building a force to build the entire team at IdeaForge together since its inception. It's a pioneer in small and mini UAV segment in India. That is the very special segment of drones. Under his leadership, IdeaForge has become the global technology leader in VTOL, micro and mini UAV space, and is the market leader in defense and homeland security. As co-chair of the FICCI committee, he has been driving the agenda for the drone segment in India along with the chair. He is also a member of the FICCI Young Leaders Forum, and he is actually playing a prominent role in the adoption of UAVs in different sectors. He has, of course, for his work, been listed in the top 35 under 35 entrepreneurs. And he is, of course, a member of the drone task force under the Government of India. So sorry for that long introduction, Ankit. You have actually achieved so much in such a little time, and we are really proud of you and proud of what you are doing. So welcome. It is a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you, Mr. Chennai. It's a pleasure to be on this chat as well.
So, I use a lot of acronyms, the UAV, VTOL, et cetera, et cetera. Many of our viewers may not actually know what this means or what actually, some would know what a drone is because everybody's been to a wedding and seen that thing flying around and taking photographs. But, just explain the total drone landscape just for the interest of our viewers.
Sure. So typically a drone, or what is otherwise also known as unmanned aerial vehicle, or in certain regulatory avatars, it is known as the remotely piloted aircraft vehicles. So these platforms are essentially autonomous. So earlier people used to fly radio controlled aircrafts. These used to be directly controlled by a user on the ground and used to fly them for hobby purposes. What happened is over a period of time, this technology evolved, and now the aircraft that used to be earlier flown as a hobby system can fly itself, and the operator on ground does not really need to give inputs to continuously fly the system. An autopilot takes care of that, but the operator can tell the drone where to go and what to do. And those kind of interactions happen via a ground control station. That ground control station communicates with the drone and gives its instructions, and those instructions are then converted into actions by the drone and its autopilot by its own. So it's a technology where you'll typically have a drone, it'll have a payload, that payload could be a camera, and then there would be a ground control station which may comprise of a remote controller and a laptop or a handheld device, which will then show what the drone is seeing or do actions as desired onto that particular area that it is operating under.
Thank you for that brief about what drones are. I'm sure viewers are much enlightened about this. But you've actually been involved exactly for the last 15 years in this space. So how has technology evolved over the last few years, and where is it headed?
Absolutely. So if I remember, our early days, this was back in 2004 when we actually built our first prototype of drones when we were still students at IIT Bombay. At that time, we did not have any element of that technology readily available, including if you look at a typical rotor that you see in weddings, it has four rotors that spin in opposite directions and therefore, are able to control their operations in flight. Even those counter-rotating propellers were not available. So I remember in the first prototype we ever built, we literally had to cut carbon steel blades and had to machine our own hubs in which it would make it counter rotating and therefore make our first prototype. From there to today, it being the hardware in some extent being a commoditized element of the platform. And times where, if you remember in the movie Three Idiots, where an early prototype of ours flew in 2009, it was a sort of a entirely new segment for the common population. And everyone was just happy seeing something fly. You know, there wasn't actually much expectation at that time. And then they wanted to see it fly for slightly longer periods of time. And the expectations grew to the extent that now today, what people are saying is that I don't care about what is flying. I care about what is it is doing for me, which means that you give me my result. If I am talking about inspection, then tell me where the crack is. I don't care whether you fly a drone that operates for this much time, that much time, or you fly a drone that does it autonomously or does it manually. Give me an outcome. Give me the analytics that I need rather than just focus on the a flying part of that entire equation. So the world has evolved significantly over the years. They expect AI, they expect autonomy, they expect performance at the same time as well.
Since that you use the Three Idiots analogy, you know, I think the Yuri would signify the evolution of drone between Three Idiots and Yuri, where this drone actually shaped as a falcon, I believe, you know, went and did a lot of things there. So it's a great analogy looking at how it is depicted in the movies. But if you look at it, what has actually spurred this? You briefly mentioned about inspection, etc. But what has spurred the growth of drones in the world, both non-defense and you know civilian use cases?
Absolutely. So if I were to look at the early days, I think democratization of technology by making it autonomous allowed a lot of people to. So earlier, flying a small aircraft was the realm of a hobbyist who would be able to take a radio control and operate it. And then there were a lot of mechanics involved and a lot of dedication was required to pick up that hobby. But now with the advent of autonomy, the technology became a little bit more accessible to a general person who is not as dedicated as a hobbyist, but still wants to experience something flying. So that's what started the entire race and democratization of the technology. And then what has happened is that while experimenting with it, people have used it for several use cases. They've explored all sorts of possible areas in which drones can be deployed to bring a difference, to bring even disruptive change as far as technology is concerned. But I would say that if I were to focus a little bit of my attention around India, then in India, while all of this was happening in the rest of the world, India remained a little slow because of our regulatory, clampdowns and a slightly less operationalized regulatory framework. But last year, something very unique happened that along with when COVID came in and there was a need for deploying technology which could remotely do a lot of things, the deployment of drones started happening without question in that one sense. And it became from a good to have to a must have in that context particularly. Then in India, the Swamitva scheme was announced where the country wants to map all the 660,000 villages in the country using drones and to create maps that will be converted to land records so that a rural villager can own his property and become part of the economic mainstream and be able to leverage his collateral. So that scheme has spurred the entire industry in a way, in a direction that GIS industry itself is changing. And with the recent announcement of opening up of the GIS policy with respect to mapping, it is completely changing the landscape as far as that enterprise use, if I may say, is concerned as far as drones are going to be there. Then in that entire time, we also had the locust operations being enabled because there was a sudden spurt of locusts and we had to protect our crops. And we felt that drones is a technology that can be deployed or leveraged for protecting from that menace. So that was deployed. So a lot of use cases last year have completely unlocked the chain. Then we had attack and the incident in Galwan happened. That incident, again, if you see, was reflective of the fact that we had no eyes on the border. And because we had no eyes on the border, we did not know of certain activities, or we became aware of them very late. So that has spurred a procurement direction as far as defense is concerned in the country. Similarly, if you reflect on the war that happened between Armenia and Azerbaijan, where Azerbaijan was able to win over Armenia purely on the strength of drones that it had. That has again, over this last year and a half, has cemented the place of drones from a good to have technology to a must have technology as far as this domain is concerned. And you see all the regulatory changes and everything that is happening is essentially trying to make sure that we can operationalize these systems post haste to deliver the economic benefit that they can bring about, and even the other collateral benefits.
Also, there's this pilot going on in Hyderabad to develop medicine, deliver medicines by drone. And of course, Amazon is talking about, and other e-commerce companies are talking about delivery by drones. So I think that's fantastic. You know, you talked about the lack of a policy earlier, but now there is a new draft policy and has given a lot of freedom to drone ecosystem. And would you like to throw some light on how this is, you talked about the GIS policy and mapping policy, but the drone policy, how is it actually spurring growth in this area?
So, it started with looking at the existing rules last year, where we realized that we will have to allow a lot of these operations as an exemption to the rules, so that these operations can be made very, very, you can say, normal as far as exploitation of the technology is concerned. Finally, drone rules, the draft rules, which are going to get notified hopefully in August, will essentially bring that exemption process, the requirement of that exemption process to a relatively much, much smaller set, and make sure that drones can be operationalized and we can move and evolve the law based on the evidences we collect on ground, rather than how it was earlier perceived, in order to prevent it or block it so much that not much can happen. And the time it takes to operationalize that setup was something which was seen as a bottleneck. So now the policy is adopting, I would say, a relatively evidence-based approach, that let's create evidence of something, massively wrong before we go and regulate it. Because if we continue to make it so restricted, it will only lead to all sorts of aftermarket. And what has happened in the past, actually, if you see, import of drones was banned, but there were still tens of thousands of drones imported into the country for wedding photography. Because there was a ban, they will never be able to become the mainstream as far as the ecosystem is concerned. So I think it is great to have an open policy to bring more people in. But of course, as all rules are there, they address a part of the challenge, and we are, even as our drone committee, recommending certain further enhancements as far as these draft rules are concerned, that will enable it to become extremely operable and make sure that we are aligned in that direction with the industry expectations even further.
Thank you for that great update. You mentioned about the Armenia-Azerbaijan war. You talked about the eyes on the border. So obviously, for every drone, there will be an anti-drone technology. So how do you see that anti-drone technology evolving, and where are we positioned in India, and what do we need to do to be on top of it?
Counter drones and drones will go hand in hand. The analogy is the typical police and thief story, right? That there'll be police and then there'll be thieves who'll do better than what technology police is using, and then police will catch up. So this is something which is going to go on. Drones as a potential threat have been a known element over the last few years, and counter drone technologies have been developed, albeit they're a little more expensive today than we would like them to be. And that's the reason why the deployment is a relatively slow deployment, because you cannot unlock purses in a manner that the technology is quite expensive today. But the technology is evolving to detect drones by using their radio waves that come out of the drones when they communicate with their handlers, or by detecting them under radars which are specifically tuned for catching low cross sections. The issue with drones is that their radar cross section is so low that it becomes very challenging for conventional radars to pick them up, and therefore there are being specific radars developed to be able to detect drones there. Then if you detect something by a radar, you typically also want to detect whether it is a bird that you have detected or you have detected an actual drone. So you typically have a camera, electro-optic camera, which also then confirms that whether it is a drone or something else. So there are technologies being developed to first detect, and then there are technologies being developed to neutralize. And the mix of ideas that people have implemented to neutralize is actually very, very fascinating. They have come up with areas where some people have actually trained falcons to catch drones, you know, at least the small ones. Some people have come up with ideas where they are capturing drones on their nets. Some people are actually just going and hitting into the drone. Then jamming is the most common way in which drones, counter drone measures are being taken. So there is a wide variety of ways in which people are wanting to counter. And the industry itself is a huge industry going forward, even in our projections, as the part of the effort that FICCI is doing with DPIIT, as drone being a priority sector. We have envisaged that a 50,000 crore potential market exists for counter drones just in our country. So it is a large potential market, and it will be addressed. And I think it will truly get deployed at large scale once the cost and benefit ratios match up really, really well.
Just as a, you know, just taking that thought a bit further, I mean, if people are developing anti-drone technology, I mean, the drone manufacturers will be developing anti-drone technology. So, you know, where is this going to end then? You know? And I think also just to add to this, you know, you talked about the unmanned aerial vehicle, right, as a drone. Now, you know, there are some very large systems which are like aircrafts or, you know, which deliver missiles, etc. So where does one draw the line here? You know, what becomes a drone and what becomes an aerial vehicle, or, you know, what is it? And then following up on that, you know, what is a drone and anti-drone technology?
So the boundary between a drone and a large aircraft, typically I would say is whether the control of the flight is in the hands of the pilot or is it in the hands of an autopilot. So if it is being flown entirely on an autopilot and the human is not directly going to control the surfaces of that aircraft, then it is typically a unmanned system. So even if you make a Boeing fly completely on autopilot, in that one sense, it is a drone that is flying because it's doing that entire mission on an autopilot. Typically, a drone mission is end-to-end controlled via an autopilot, and an operator can give instructions to do a specific task, but not really bother about actual flying of that aircraft. Whereas in an aircraft, you can actually fly it in a manned aircraft. So that's the distinction, right? But in terms of counter drone, and you put out a great point that, you know, if there is going to be a counter drone system, then you have to have a counter drone system as well. Because, so there are 3-4 issues, right? It's not like when you are operating a counter drone system, you don't want to operate your own drones because you want to protect anything which is coming from the air, but you also want to protect what is going to come up on the ground. And to be able to see what is coming on the ground, drones are a great asset because they can scan the ground as if they are a mobile CCTV camera that can be positioned in a pattern, in a fixed location or whatever. So there will, one, be a requirement for whitelisting these systems in a way that they are identifiable and whitelist, and the alarm is not raised on every drone that takes off. If it is a friendly drone, then it doesn't cause an alarm. And if it is a drone which is not identified, it may cause a alarm. But also, for example, typical methods in which drones are being prevented from entering a space is to jam their communication or their GPS signals. If that jamming happens, then there are technologies that can counter communication jamming as well as they can counter. So communication jamming in a wide band can be mainly controlled by switching frequencies or something like that to entirely different frequencies, if that entire frequency band is not jammed. But beyond a point, that's probably impractical, right? You will be able to jam it. So then the system will fly autonomous. So it will have to have the ability to take independent autonomous decisions. Then GPS denied capability. So operating in an environment where there is no GPS signal. Again, that is something which people are working on and is available on certain platforms and being developed on other platforms as well, including we are developing such technology. So there are going to be counters to each particular method of countering a drone. And if there is an incoming kinetic drone which is trying to go and collide with you, there will be evasive maneuvers that you will have to take. So it's going to be an interesting complex field that will continue to and let's say, for example, what Hamas did with Israel, right? Israel has the Iron Dome system. Hamas said, let me fire 4,000 rockets or 5,000 rockets or maybe 10,000 rockets. Let me see how many can they protect against, right? And the fact is that system was success, great up to, let's say, 90% of the incoming, but 10% did make their way to the ground. So it's going to be a very complex game. And, that's what technology does. It gets you into these loops, particularly on this side.
It looks straight out of a science fiction movie, right? But, you're actually at the cutting edge of making it a reality. But, a lot of people have talked about air taxis and, all other things like that. How do you see the use of drones in actually transportation? Unmanned aerial vehicle or a drone transporting people. So, how does that seem to pan out?
No, I think, honestly, it is an imperative on us that we do that, right? And particularly, we do it using certain green technologies. Because, one, the ground infrastructure can only scale as much. As far as transportation is concerned. And it is slow, it is dependent on infra, which is very expensive to build, and it takes a lot of time to build as well. So the progress on infra on ground is a very hard and very slow paced. Whereas if you look at vertical takeoff and landing drones that can also ferry people, which is typically known as, unmanned aerial mobility, then, that can truly unlock unlock the third dimension for people to move or for goods to move. Maybe it will begin with at least last mile and middle mile deliveries to start happening in the air. And then people will move, particularly passengers may move in the air. And then slowly and slowly, the ground infrastructure will be free to move things that really are the most economically moved there. And the third dimension is there for people to move from point to point because that's faster. That's, it has more volume carrying capability potentially in the future as well.
Like you have these air traffic controllers for aircrafts. I mean, if you imagine if 1.35 billion people in India start flying, what type of system would you require, how would it be controlled and how would it be mandated, or it'll be a line of sight thing?
No, it will be managed via what is known as unmanned traffic management systems. And these systems are going to become increasingly autonomous. Unmanned traffic management will be autonomous as well as integrating it with manned transport, manned aviation. So these systems will integrate and create a seamless picture of the sky and make sure that based on every system's capability, it is able to suggest the right route, the right method of mitigating collision and those kind of incidental scenarios.
So, it's been quite fascinating listening to you about your journey from IIT Mumbai days of, as a hobby and then, actually creating a whole new industry, your views on, where drones will be used, what's the policy landscape and, what's the future going forward. Just taking from your logo, which is behind you, just hope that you continue to create a huge lot of new technology and new stuff. And continue to inspire the young people around the world. So thank you very much for having this chat and wish you all the very best going forward.
Thank you, Mr. Chinoy. It was a pleasure speaking with you on this fascinating topic, which remains fascinating for me till date.
Thank you.